I'm Simon Ola. I'm a pipeline developer at Rise. I worked like the last 3 years on our integration of USD and Solaris.
Hey, I'm Andreas Giesen, working as a VFX supervisor at Rise for a few years now, starting as a VFX2.
Rise decided to switch to a USD pipeline, and you were the mastermind behind this initiative.
I was the first one to hear about Solaris being added to Houdini, and that it will be based on USD. And I was always working on the Houdini pipeline, and so having Solaris being based on USD was our access to USD, actually. So yeah, that's why we got into it.
When did the studio decide to put this pipeline in place, and what were the main reasons behind this choice?
It's centered around Solaris,
okay.
Because USD, initially heard that USD was open sourced. We of course wanted to test it. We compiled it, and we ran the initial plugins in Houdini and Maya, and it was interesting. But with Solaris, we had the option to prototype super quickly by building these node networks to test out the different composition orders. So it made it accessible for us, because we were not so many pipeline developers at that time, to really decide to go that route and do a USD-based pipeline. Then we just spent a lot of time doing R&D. We started with the Houdini 18 alpha, so it was not yet released or available for public. And then there were many things to figure out USD-wise, how you would structure your files, your layers, your shots, your asset USD. And then, yeah, we spent a lot of time on this. Then we had a recipe, and then we just integrated it, connected it to RiseBase, our in-house database, and then did the connection to Maya. And everything was just, that progress.
Can you walk us through the way you implemented and deployed this new pipeline?
Everyone was very excited about it, but as you also just mentioned, it was a complete change of the workflow.
Yeah.
So basically getting the artists on that they could work with the efficiency as before, they had to be trained, with this new pipeline. And I think that's why also, so by now we have more training material, in-house training in place than ever before, actually, to get the people working within the pipeline.
One bonus for us as a company was that we've always been Houdini-based for lighting and rendering. Artists that worked in that area, they immediately saw the benefits and gains that you would have in using this USD pipeline, because now that you have in Solaris, you have this interactive view that just always, Karma is always on and always rendering. That's exciting, I guess, for everyone.
How this new pipeline been accepted by artists? Did you get any unpleasant surprises?
There were things we spent a lot of time. We now know that we need an asset resolver, and we have one, and it works nice. But to do versioning in USD, because it kind of have a push pipeline now, where something gets pushed and it is available for other artists, but you need to make sure that when you send something to the farm, it is pinned to a specific version. And if another push happens, it will not switch mid-render. And to do this, initially we tried to work around this with other things, but the way to do it is having an asset resolver. And that was a challenge for us, because when we started, we didn't have like a huge team of C++ developers or something, but then there was also an open source version from RodeoFX, from their asset resolver, and that was a huge help. So that got us into doing this, and then we modified it slightly to fit our needs, and then that was solved. And other things would be, they sound simple, but for example, just doing material overrides on a large set of instance server references is not, it's not trivial. You could, there are ways to do it that are not efficient, but we were after the efficient way, and this was quite a challenge, and several other ones that then also you kind of release stuff, and then you realize, oh, now we run into this one issue where we didn't think of. So of course this always happens, but for now I think we're good.
NVIDIA is heavily pushing Omniverse. What are your thoughts on this collaboration platform? Do you think a studio such as Rise would benefit from using it?
I don't know too much about Omniverse. I mean, I saw some of the videos. It looks really nice. It seems that it's very much focused also around their Create suite, which to me also seems like a 3D package. And that's something we currently would not consider, because again, we're centered around Houdini. For now, I don't think we would switch to that way of working. And some of the demos, you see this collaborative workflow that is live. And I don't think for now, if you're doing lookdev on an asset, you would want to see that the tire gets scaled up because another department is working on this, which was some of the nice ways to show this connection. This is something I guess we would do, because we always go through these approval steps. One department finishes that layer and then it gets moved on. It is interesting and we'll definitely watch it, but it's not something we would quickly implement.
AI is another hot topic. Are you using or planning to use deep learning at RISE?
We're experimenting, I think, with some face replacement technologies, but it's more in the comp department and people looking into it there. Also in comp, comp is looking into it. But of course, like everyone on LinkedIn, I was also playing around with Midjourney, for example. This, I think, is really powerful to get, like, just generate data, generate concept elements that you can then mix and match to get the concepts.
But also for 3D side, FX side, it will get more and more interesting. Looking at also like fluid simulations, which are enhanced by using AI, or we, I think we just released that the new VDB format is coming, which is tremendously reduced in size and also based on some compression algorithms which use AI. I think it's definitely coming.
The future of USD has been discussed in several SIGGRAPH talks this year. What improvements would you like to see in the coming months and years?
There is already great adoption, but even better ones, like for us in Maya. The plugin currently is nice, but there are things that are super cool in Houdini that we would also like to see in Maya, just in the way it is represented and displayed in the viewport there. But one thing that is super exciting are procedural payloads. So I think there's still some time until they will be officially in the USD. But what SideFX now did, they have these HAS procedurals, and they would generate geometry live for your USD renderer. But it can then be understood and read by all the delegates. So that is super exciting. For example, they use it as a FIR procedural. I think this is gonna develop, so it will be even more flexible to create USDs on the fly.
Do you have any advice for studios that are considering adopting USD?
Yes, I mean, I can just say how we did it. For us, it was, we definitely want to go full USD. There's ways you can just, for a specific department, write out USD files because maybe it's more efficient, or use scattering and instancing there. But definitely the best way to do it is to export from every GCC your USD files and to have a short USD layer. Otherwise, you're just getting half the benefits of what it's supposed to be. But this required for us a really long R&D time. Like I said, we wanted to figure out all the issues before we then started to implement. We still ran into issues later on, but it helped a lot to know that, yeah, material overrides are tricky, or we need an asset resolver, but because otherwise we're stuck at the other area. So yeah, spent that initial time. And one recommendation there that helped us a lot, prototype in Solaris. Again, Houdini, you don't have to write like everything with the Python API. It's so fast to test out different composition arcs there. And because there's in USD, there's something that's called liver piece, which is the order of how the different composition arcs are layered, how strong they are. And this can cause a lot of pain if you're not doing it right. So that's a great way to test these things out.
How does USD change the workflow in VFX?
You definitely did. Because it makes all the workflow much more efficient, I would say. So, I mean, for sure, it was a challenge. The first project on a new pipeline, we ran into a few issues, as you mentioned also already, but in the end, all those were figured out, and now I'm really looking forward to the next project with this even refined pipeline. And, you know, more efficiency in the end means there's more time to refine stuff. The artists have more fun, so they get more creative. So it's not about so much anymore about you waiting for scenes to open, figuring out technical issues. I mean, all the stuff is more streamlined, so they can more focus on the really doing great lighting, really getting into the shot and focusing on the artistical stuff.
Probably in the future with USD it will be even easier to exchange assets, because then you can even exchange like material assignments, in theory even complete sets or light setups.
You worked on Matrix Resurrection. How did RISE get involved on the show? And what are the main sequences you worked on?
One of our founders, Robert, he got in contact with the producers. So yeah, I also heard that we're going to work on this show and was really excited for sure, and a bit intimidated. For most of the people, like working on the Matrix is something really exciting. So in my younger age, I was one of the reasons why I'm doing this job now. Everybody hoped for also to be able to work on this exciting stuff, like bullet time effects from Agent Smith and all the stuff. And in the end, we really got a sequence.
It's a sequence where they're fighting in the basement and in this factory environment. Neo gets pushed against the wall by Agent Smith. He's moving so fast, this effect we had to replicate from the old movies, really looking at in detail, frame by frame, analyzing how this effect was set up back then. The same was for the bullet time. We really analyzed all the old movie scenes because the idea was, even though it should be somehow updated, it should still keep the essence of this effect. So we really had to look into it and make sure to get this into the new bullet time effect as well. So that was exciting.
For the flashback scenes with Neo at the top of the building, you created some impressive city environments. How did you approach these shots?
Those shots were also quite interesting because Lana and Dan also for VFX Soup had a clear vision what they would like to transport with those shots. So it should have this dream kind of feeling because it's this flashback scenes. To get the city environment going, they basically provided quite some drone footage of the city. So it was not like a complete build of the like a 3D city or something. We really had a rough geometry and were projecting the drone footage they provided us onto the geometry, and so that worked out because I think they really planned it well. You know, that's why it worked out. It wasn't right camera angles. The time of day was matching.
Some of the shots you worked are in slow motion. How this affects, you know, the work of the crew?
They also shot everything with high frame rate already on set, so we could slow everything down. But it was also a lot of playing with read time. So it was not like another movie, okay, you just have half slow motion, that's it. It was really about tricky read times, speeding it up again, slowing it down. It was quite clear what they provided refs from editorial we had to match in the end. As always, for sure, there's also then in the end quite some cleanup involved to get those slow motion shots going.
Rise worked on the sati sequence in Construct. We heard that it was quite a challenge due to lighting issues. Can you tell us about it?
Sati sequence was really a challenge. A few shots were shot on location, but most of the stuff was, I think it was like additional photography shot in front of a green screen. The lighting was not optimal, I would say. So it was not matching exactly the scenes that were shot on location. So we had to not just basically put a background, make sure that it fits the plate. It was more like enhancing the plate a lot with color corrections, gradings, to really make it work, that it was believable that they were standing in the woods and not in front of a green screen. Also, there was a collaboration with Lola for some shots doing the face replacement. We were providing the comp, so yeah, that worked out well.
One thing interesting about this asset exchange, I think in the future, is also with USD, that I think there's work being done by Vader and probably ILM or some companies to now there's the universal scene description, but something to have a unified universal scene description. To have a common asset structure so that the interchange between companies would be easier. So this is definitely something really interesting for the future.
Most recently, you worked on Last Voyage of Demeter, which will be released next year. Can you tell us about the effects?
It's a very challenging project. I mean, first USD project, but also just the scope of project. We're dealing with a lot of full CG shots with a ship in a storm, for example. Also massive set extensions, especially the large scale fluid simulation part. We really put to a next level doing this project. So that was the most exciting.
Due to the pandemic, remote work has been very common in the VFX industry. As a supervisor, how did you approach it? And do you think studio will keep relying on remote work?
I can speak for our pipeline department, which, for example, is now fully remote. We were just having a meeting again, the full pipeline department from the different locations, meeting again, first time, meeting some people the first time because they came in after the pandemic and then we never saw them live. And then we really decided that it would probably be nice to see each other in the office more. And so our plan now is to go there 2 days a week and work 3 days remotely. So I think this is somehow, at least for our department, the future, this hybrid model, because there are definitely benefits to working from home, but it's also good to see the people from time to time.
I really enjoy with working people in the office because it just the communication is easier. For example, if everybody's just in an online conference room, you not have your mic and camera on all the time, so people do not get a feeling what's going on at the moment. Is it a stressful moment? Are we just in delivery? Maybe they are, why are not getting an answer to a question or something? And if you're all in the same room, you directly get, okay, they're just busy. They're dealing with a delivery or something like this. Yeah, there are just some parts lost in the communication. So not everybody's on the same page. On the other hand, I think it will definitely go to this hybrid model because it opens up also more flexibility. Artists can work for Rise, which basically couldn't do it before. So that opens also up new possibilities. But yeah, I think it's like a few days in the office, and then but having this flexibility to be also at some point at home, if there's a special reason, I think that's very helpful. I think everybody, because there's also the demand, there's such a high demand that content gets delivered, so they need every artist available to do the job.
But there definitely were these restrictions before COVID.
Yeah.
So that is what changed this. But it definitely looks like it's not gonna go back.
What have you seen at SIGGRAPH? What papers or talk did you see?
To be honest, I have not seen too many talks. We were at the Houdini sessions, most of them. It was really interesting to see how other people are handling USD and Solaris. But for me now, that is really because there's still so much work to do. I wanted to watch the Omniverse presentation. I think it's still on. So yeah, that area is material workflows in general, how keeping it overwritable, flexible, that kind of thing is what I'm interested in.
Same thing here, I also didn't see so many presentations, but I think there was one about like new fluid solvers, like for large-scale water simulations, I think it was from Veda. Yeah, that's definitely something. Also our TDs were joining those sessions, so yeah, we're definitely looking into this.